Okay, welcome to another episode of the On.NET Show. Today we're going to be talking with my colleague, Peter Marcu, and we're going to be talking about Raspberry Pi, IoT, ARM32, and all that good stuff. So, what are we talking about? Like, what is this ARM32, IoT, Raspberry Pi? What are those things?
All right, so yeah, ARM32, Raspberry Pi, IoT are things that we talk about generally in this IoT space, which are a bunch of devices, Internet of Things, things that you can do with a bunch of these really small devices like Raspberry Pis that can do amazing things for $35 and really unlocks a lot of possibilities. People are doing smart homes and general like compute in the cloud using large arrays of these things, and it's really a cool space. So it's something we've been exploring for a little while now.
Okay, so this device that we see here, we might need to kind of lift it up a tiny bit. Okay, there we go. So this is a Raspberry Pi, right?
Yeah, this is a Raspberry Pi.
And I sometimes hear these different terms like Raspberry Pi 2, Raspberry Pi 3. I guess there was a 1, and then there's also a 0.
Yes.
Which one is this?
So this is a Raspberry Pi 3. Raspberry Pi 3 and Raspberry Pi 2 are very similar. Raspberry Pi 3 is just an updated version that has more memory and greater CPU power. But a lot of the pins and everything on there is the same between 2 and 3.
Okay.
Then you mentioned the Pi Zero, which is actually a different processor that has a reduced set of instructions. I think it's ARMv6 instruction set as opposed to ARMv7. And ARMv7 is what .NET depends on. So as of right now, and some of the demos we show you, we're literally talking about ARMv7 instruction sets. So Raspberry Pi 2, Raspberry Pi 3 is what we're looking at.
Okay. So, you know, when I go on YouTube, sometimes I see people, and on search term Raspberry Pi, I sometimes see people using the Raspberry Pi, I guess what I would call as a computer. And then I sometimes see them using it as like an IoT device that takes advantage of the sensors and that kind of thing. So can you talk about is it the same device that you use in both cases? Can you talk to that?
Yeah, people use Raspberry Pis in both cases. In my office, I have a Raspberry Pi hooked up doing 4K monitor as a full desktop. It's got LibreOffice and all kinds of things running on it. So it's a full-fledged client. It's slow. It's not the processor you'd normally have on a desktop workstation.
It's not an Intel i7
or
i9.
No, it's not. But it's functional and it does what it needs to do for small things.
I actually know my neighbor has one hooked up with I think it's the Kudu or Kudo media server.
Yeah. Yeah, people are using it all over the place for media center type things, recording streams off the internet and putting them on their NAS.
Right. Okay, so how about you walk us through what's actually on this board? Because super cool. What are we seeing?
Yeah, so
here?
I'll just stick at a high level, but basically this board has 4 USB ports so you can connect all kinds of devices to it, Ethernet. It has this array of GPIO ports, which we'll talk about a little bit more in the demo we're going to show. You can hook it up to a camera. You can hook it up to a display. It has HDMI port. It has the mini HDMI for power, and then it has the ability to plug in a wall wart to be able to power it as well. It's got the processor, and it's got the SD card kind of on the back here. And
that's where our OS is.
That's it. That's where the OS is. That's where everything's running off of. I think it's got a 16 gig card in there right now, but most of the distros and everything that you need to run on it can happen in about 8 gigs.
Okay, and tell us which operating systems you can install on that.
So I've done various things. Windows IoT obviously runs on this. Raspberry Pi. Raspberry has a distro called Raspbian that runs on here. Ubuntu Mate is something that you can run on here. Those are the three that I've done.
Okay, or isn't it Mate?
Mate.
Yeah.
So I've run those on this Pi. And it's really nice because I can leave the whole hardware configuration the same, and I can just swap out the SD card, and it all works kind of the same.
Yeah, the one I normally run is Raspbian, because with our the other Linux work that you and I actually do together for .NET Core, there we mostly focus on Debian. So Raspbian, which is basically the Raspberry Pi version of Debian,
right,
as you know.
Right.
That's why it's called that. That's one I usually use. It sticks with the same version, so there's a Raspbian version for Jesse, which is what we kind of used to focus on, and there's another one called Stretch,
right,
which is what we kind of use now, right. So that's the one I installed.
And today I have Raspbian on here, so that's what we'll be looking
at. Okay, and are you using Stretch or Jesse?
I believe it's Stretch.
Okay.
Yeah, but I don't remember.
Let's look at this fancy gear, because this looks crazy.
Yeah, so let me walk through the rest of the hardware. Is that what you're...
Yeah.
So we'll demo something very simple, but we have samples, and I can show you where they are, of controlling a lot of different sensors that are available in the ecosystem. And very common ones are things like light sensors, potentiometers. This is barometric pressure sensor with temperature and all kinds of other goodies on it. LEDs, obviously. There's a digital analog converter. I think that's what I've got on here today. But basically, all of these things interact with the Raspberry Pi through GPIO and usually use common protocols like SPI or I2C. So it's really about just hooking them up, getting the right libraries to connect to them, and then interacting with them.
Right. So I would imagine to use one of those, you probably need like super low level C++ code or like crazy pinvokes.
You do and you don't. It turns out there's a great ecosystem around this stuff, and there's C++ libraries and libraries in a bunch of languages that are available to interact with all of these things. So in a lot of these demos that I'm giving, there's a very popular library called WiringPy that's a C++ library that has language bindings from a bunch of different languages. So I'm using a .NET library that has language bindings to WiringPy. So all of the protocols and all the GPIO interop happens in that library, and then we just write nice abstractions for the hardware on top of that library.
Okay, so what are you going to show us first? This device actually doing something, or show us the code?
Let's look at the project real quick. Let's look at the code that controls the Raspberry Pi.
So we might want to just make that a tiny bit bigger.
Okay. So here's a very simple, I have a set of projects here, but a very simple project here is a .NET Core 2.0 application.
So if you do, okay.
And this is just the boilerplate code that you would use to blink an LED. You can see you kind of initiate the GPIO driver, to choose which pin you're going to use to control the LED, and then just do a simple loop to toggle the LED from true to false, where the important thing here is you're writing the LED state, the high or low on the pin.
Okay, so we never actually defined what GPIO means, because it's an acronym, right?
Yeah, GPIO is General Purpose I/O. So it's just the general way that you interact with external devices from the Raspberry Pi.
Right, input-output.
Yes, input-output.
So whenever I see these while loops here, because I've seen this type of code before, I always have this idea that like the device is going to burn up or something like that. That doesn't happen.
No, it doesn't. And it's using a thread and looping through with a sleep. So no, it's not an infinite. I mean, it's an infinite loop, but it's not. It's not running out of control.
Yeah, exactly. Right.
So this is the project, and as I said, it's a .NET Core 2.0 application. And where would that terminal go?
Here. There it is.
Okay, so you can see here, this is that project that I was just in, and it's. In order to build it, you do your normal interactions with it, so .NET build, .NET run, except .NET running it isn't really useful because you're on a Mac here, or you could be on Windows, and running this code doesn't have GPIO, it doesn't have all the drivers, it doesn't have everything ready. So .NET run isn't that interesting. What's really important is that you kind of create a self-contained application or an application that can run on the framework that's on the device. So what we do is effectively do a .NET publish -r to say to a specific runtime, and then we do Linux ARM, because that's the target architecture and OS of the device. So once we do that, it'll create in this folder here, in the Linux ARM publish folder, an application. Now, I won't do it here today, but all we do is copy that folder over to the Raspberry Pi, and you just start to run it. So the next thing we can do is pop over to the Pi. So let's see, do we have that up here?
Oh,
there we
okay.
go.
Perfect.
There
that
we
was,
go.
That was quick.
So here, let me get focus right.
Yeah. You're not quite there. There we go.
Okay. So here, there's our application. It was copied into this blink LED folder. And I can do a sudo blink LED. Now, you have to run a sudo because access to the GPIO is an admin operation. So running a sudo is critical here.
Okay, so now we started it. Now I assume it's just gonna sit there because I didn't see in the console right
now. So that's running our code. Now we can jump over here to the OS again. There we go. So the LED's blinking, and that's what we've got running.
Okay, yeah, we can see that on the screen.
Yeah, I think I can see it over here. So.
Okay. That didn't help.
There we go.
Yeah, so that'll just keep on blinking forever. Now, you know, if we had another, let's kind of just conceptually make this a little more interesting. If we'd had like a temperature sensor,
right?
Maybe we could cause the blinking to start, you know, above 70 degrees Celsius
Right. So if we go back to the Mac here.
Some temperature, not that temperature.
I've got another sample, which I don't have all the wires hooked up, so I can't demo it, but this is effectively exercising all of those different sensors that are on the board today. So you can see how it sets up all of these different serial interfaces and protocols. It does the same thing, except the thing that's controlling the LED in this case is actually down here. It's the state of the motion sensor. So when the motion sensor has been activated, the LED turns on.
Okay.
And when it hasn't been active for a period of time, I forgot what it was set to, it turns back off.
Yeah.
Right. So you can also see in here, we're reading stuff for the temperature, we're outputting the pressure and the temperature that's currently there, reading the potentiometers to say where we are on the analog values. So all those sensors right here on the board are being controlled in what, 60, 70 lines of code?
Yeah.
So we're getting a lot of data flowing in. All this data could be uploaded to the cloud, processed there, doing different things.
Right. Now, I see some console.write lines there. I assume from like a pure runtime scenario, those console.write lines wouldn't be super interesting.
Yeah, those aren't interesting. But in a demo, you would be able to see these pressure gauges and everything outputting. So I could cover up the light sensor, and you'd see the stream of data change in the value of light that's coming. And it's just a way for them to make it easy to see and not have to go through a whole end-to-end.
Right, or you could be pushing that data to the cloud.
Right, you could replace those console write lines with push data to wherever you want to push it.
Yeah, okay. Makes sense. Do you see people like adopting this kind of model at all? Like,
I first put up instructions on how to do this Raspberry Pi stuff probably about 6 months ago now.
Yeah.
And immediately I started getting people telling me that it worked or it didn't work and what they were trying to do with it. And we've had people take what I've done here and go to conferences and demo them and create really cool devices and connecting them to Azure and connecting them to different services and creating whole end-to-ends. And it's been really fun watching, you know, people come out of the woodwork and wanting to play with this. I know Scott Hanselman right now is playing with creating a whole cluster of Raspberry Pis running code like this using the libraries that I've sent him.
So can you tell me two things? One is, what is the thing that you found most challenging? And what was the thing that you found most surprisingly easy?
Okay. So assuming you've already gotten over the hurdle of working with hardware, working with electronics, so knowing how to read voltages, knowing how to kind of debug the signals that are coming through these things, once you've gotten over that hurdle, which is probably the hardest hurdle for someone that's just lived in software for a long time, once you get past that, the hurdles actually were more of the trying to integrate with different protocols and different control boards. So, for example, reading the specification for the barometric pressure sensor to understand when I get a value of high, it means this, and kind of mapping that to something that makes sense. So it's still the hardware to software translation layer. Now, the nice thing is there's a lot of libraries out there for a lot of popular boards that have already done that abstraction for you. So, for example, I have a whole base set of libraries here that I'm using that came from the Mono community that really helped with getting the whole thing bootstrapped. So it's really when you stray from what a lot of people have done and you start getting into your own custom boards or your own custom configurations that's probably the hardest part.
Okay. Makes sense. One of the questions that I was talking to you about earlier was, that we actually don't have an answer for yet, is Scott Hanselman is creating this kind of array of Raspberry Pis. And I've seen pictures of people having these towers with the plastic and everything.
Right.
To use all of them, you need to find out what their IP address is.
Right.
And we were speculating on how he might be doing that.
Yeah, and we don't really know the answer, but Yeah, it is one of the other challenges you do hit is you wire this whole thing up, and in order to connect to it through any type of development environment to just do, you know, PuTTY or SCP or any of the different things to connect to it, you need to know the IP address. So you've got to find a way to figure out what IP address it got. So usually you end up hooking up a monitor, hooking up a keyboard, running some commands to get the IP address, and using that and then hoping it never changes, or going possibly and setting a static IP on it.
Right, because I think that's one of the interesting things is these are still fundamentally real computers running a modern operating system. And so they mostly just rely on, I guess it's DHCP,
right,
for getting an IP address.
That's right. And we were just talking, it would be super cool if, you know, there was a little LED on here that would tell you the current IP address of the boards. You didn't have to go wandering around trying to find it. I would never have to connect a bunch of hardware to these things. I literally would just plug them in and let them connect to Wi-Fi and get an IP address, except that I have to find the IP address. And that's getting started. That's kind of one of the more painful parts of it.
Cool. Well, I think we've learned a bunch today. I really like that device. We're like, it's the breadboard, right? That's what that thing is called?
Yeah, the breadboard.
Yeah, I don't think you ever said that word.
Yep. That's just used for prototyping, protoboard, breadboard.
Yeah, exactly. So if people want to learn more about this and kind of do this at home, where would you suggest they go?
So we have a getting started. Let's see. It's at .NET Core. I think it's under samples.
Yeah.
Nope.
Well, you go to Core because you're missing like the blob master thing. Links don't work that way.
And then we have a Raspberry Pi instructions.
Cool.
So there's this whole thing here. And then, like I said, there's a bunch of libraries up on NuGet. If you just search for Pi, you're probably likely to find the ones that might work for your scenarios and go and link them in or reference them in and start playing around.
Right. I guess I should also point out there's this announcement that we created that gives you, tells you about ARM32 builds being available generally. And this link from samples is there. So that's at .NET/announcements, and this one happens to be issue 29. On GitHub, so I recommend people take a look at that. We'll include the link at the end of the video. Okay, well, this is great. Thanks for telling us about Raspberry Pi and how to do IoT, and I'm sure all the folks are going to do that at home. So thanks for watching another episode of On.NET, and I hope you learned something today. Thanks.